A little bit late, but not so bad. I hope you're enjoying your time here. If there's anything wrong, please let us know. If there's anything right, you can tell us as well. I just have a few announcements before we begin this session. Today is a very tightly scheduled day. So I would ask the chairs to please keep the timing. Don't go over time, because that means that we keep delaying the sessions throughout the day. The second coffee in the afternoon is a shorter one, because we really want to finish before 6 o'clock, well before 6 o'clock, so that people can get on the bus. Okay? If you can, try to have the session finish earlier, because we put less papers in the last session. The buses for the cooperative visit leave at 6 o'clock, okay, in front of the Brasolo. There's two or three buses. There's one bus that leaves at 8 o'clock for those who do not want to do the cooperative visit. Okay? The cooperative visit is not a messy farm. You don't need farm boots or anything, so don't worry. And if you do want to change for dinner, it's not a fancy dinner. It's by the beach, and it's quite nice, but it's not a gala. You perhaps might think about going in the second cafe back to your room and making any changes there. But the buses do need to leave at 6, because the visit's quite a tight visit. We're going to be visiting under Michael Cook's terms, a spawn or some sort of spin-off. It's a cooperative that is totally dedicated to organic production. And they're also different for Almeria in the sense that they also got into food processing as well, so not just fresh produce. And it's a small group, and they've had a spectacular success, very, very interesting business strategies that they've taken. Very committed to environmental issues, and yet they've had an amazing financial success. So I hope you enjoy the visit. And also, I think it'll be really interesting for you to see the production model here. It's probably very unlike your green pastures in many countries where we have visitors from. Okay, that's about it for announcements, except that if you are a chair, we've asked you to fill out a form to highlight the most interesting things in your sessions. I'd like to have those by tomorrow morning, if you can. If you don't have time to write them up, and also for the repertoire, so if you don't have time to write everything up, at least drop off a list of main ideas and leave it with the front desks, and then they'll give it to me. And then tomorrow morning, I have a little bit of time to put everything together, and at the closing session, we can have a very, very broad overview of what's been happening at the conference, right? Because it's a very busy conference, there's lots of papers, and we can't be everywhere at once. Okay. That's it. I'm going to introduce our panel now. We have our speaker, Professor Hans Groeneveld. Thank you very much for coming. Very, very pleased to have you here. And then we have a panel as well, which will comment on Professor Groeneveld's intervention. He's a professor of financial services cooperatives at the TS School of Business and Society at Tilburg University in the Netherlands. He's also a senior vice president of Cooperative and Governance Affairs at Rabobank. He's, I understand, entered the university in 2015, and thus I imagine you have quite a strong link between cooperative research and cooperative practice, focused on member-based enterprises. The research work that has been done by you, I think, shows that co-op financial institutions are more stable than other financial service institutions. There's been findings that they're higher capital levels, less volatile returns on assets and equities, et cetera, which is a very interesting finding during the times of crisis, and was certainly something that was very important for our local economy, given the times of austerity, that we had a very strong cooperative bank. The presentation today is based on a report commissioned by the ICA. I won't describe it because it's in the abstracts and also on a sheet of paper that you have, that Hans has provided for you. And then we'll have a commentary by three people, by Professor Dante Cracogna, who has so many distinctions, I can't list them all. So let's just say that he's a lawyer and a professor of commercial law in the University of Buenos Aires. He's been very, very kind, come a very long way. We've made him work tremendously hard while he's been here, because it's not only me, but professors at the university who have taken him for workshops and talks, and et cetera. We also have Professor Pilar Alguacil, who's a professor from the University of Valencia, the Institute of Research on Social Economy and Cooperatives, and she's a faculty member at in the Department of Financial and Tax Law. And finally, we have Professor Michael Cook, professor at the University of Missouri, and he holds the Robert Partridge Chair in the Department of Agricultural Economics. Michael has been, personally for me, a great influence on my work, but also on this conference, because a lot of what we're doing here, looking at the stages, et cetera, has been based on the research that he's done. So I'm extremely, extremely pleased that he's also here. Okay, Hans, I'll give this to you.
Thank you very much. I have a micro here. So. Yeah, dear Cynthia, thank you very much for your introduction. Nice words. Also for organizing this conference together with many other people. Very well organized. I really enjoy it. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to be here. Well, you know that, in fact, yeah, I do lead a double life. I'm a professor, but at the same time I work at Rabobank. Also heavily involved in all kinds of cooperatives and the cooperative sector. Today, I'm going to speak about a project from the ICA, commissioned by the ICA, that I've been working on for the last year. It's almost finished. Show you the cover here, you have the scoop, and as I speak, this report is posted on the website of the Alliance. At the end of my presentation, I'll show you the link, so you have to wait for this until my presentation, otherwise you're going to read it already. It's a very thick report, and it's a very big caveat that I will speak too long, because I'm so much into it, and so much work on this, so I will be very unbalanced. Not very nuanced, but you can read all the nuances, all the facets of doing cooperative business around the world in this report. I also know that noticed that by looking at the conference and the abstracts in the book you got, that actually many of the topics that will be addressed and are addressed during this conference that are touched upon also in this report. It's about governance, it's about the importance of statistics, it's about cooperative law. All many sessions are devoted to this, membership policy whatsoever. It's all been tackled as well from a macro level in this report. I also noted that quite some people in the room I already know and I already quoted in terms of references in this report. So actually nobody can disagree with me because I used your information. I also, apart from reading the literature, I also spoke with many experts in the field regarding cooperative business in a broader sense of the word, and some of them are here as well. So thank you for your input, and you agree with me as well. So this is the report, doing cooperative business. Why is this report written? Why did the ICA commission this report? Well, the ICA has the ambition to publish to disclose on a regular basis doing cooperative business reports for particular countries, continents, or whatsoever. So is it easy to set up a cooperative, yes or no? What's the enabling environment in certain countries? Is it enabling or disabling the establishment and further growth of cooperatives? So Hans, please develop a methodological framework for such a report. And that's what I've done. I think very hard. At the same time, I developed this methodology. I thought, well, let's try to see whether it works or not. So I already did a pilot for 33 countries to see whether this works or not at this level. And perhaps your country is included in this report as well. It's not finished yet, and I've also concluded with some recommendations. And I'm very happy to say that some of these recommendations are already taken up by the ACA by follow-up projects that are currently undertaken. So, large endeavor, but I'm very proud of this, and I'll show you also my way of formulating this report with all the ups and downs and the depressions I had along the way, I must admit. So this was the background. Then I'll speak about, the determinants of cooperative performance, the cooperative economy, the proliferation of cooperatives worldwide. So what are the factors, actually? What is determining the size of the cooperative economy in certain countries? And here you already touch upon a very crucial issue. What are cooperatives? Mutuals, associations, social enterprises. Very difficult. I'm not going into this, but that's already a thing. Anyway, what's the size of the cooperative economy? And what are the determinants? And many determinants are touched upon in papers that are presented here at this conference. Then I'll speak about features of cooperative dimensions in these countries. What I've looked at, not all, but what did I do, what did I find, especially regarding cooperative law, which is one of the elements constituting the enabling environment. It's not the center of the universe, but it's just one element, I must say. That's what I noted. Then I'll show you some empirical results regarding, the figures I collected, or I found, actually, readily available database, the best one I could find. I have a lot of comments and criticism about this database, but it's the best you can get, and I know that also many papers devoted here stressing the importance of having data. Yes, when you want to write a doing cooperative business report on a regular basis, you should know what is done at the cooperative business level. So you need data, otherwise this report is useless. So very important to have more readily available and high quality data, consistent data as well, by the way. Then I'll define the enabling environment as well. What is the enabling environment? This was the first hurdle, or one of the first hurdles. It's a multifaceted phenomenon, highly complex. So how do you define the enabling environment? Which factors should you look at when saying something about the environment in which cooperatives have to operate? There are many different factors. I'll talk about it later on. But I also found qualitative, quantitative indicators telling us something about the environment in which cooperatives have to operate. And then I'll end up with some conclusions. Well, first of all, I've developed a kind of cascade, because when you want to say something about the cooperatives and whether they will be established or not, it all starts with the one basic question: is there a need for cooperatives to be established? If people in country would live in a paradise, perhaps there is no need for cooperatives. Is then the environment better or worse for cooperatives? Or no, you can't say that, you know. So it's about unmet needs in society. Are people excluded, exploited? Do they have social motives? Whatever. So if there's a perceived need with people having the same objections, the same objects, I would say, and the same needs, shared ambitions, well, that is a necessary condition to set up a cooperative, obviously. Suppose that is the case, then is the question, is it really possible to set up a cooperative and to grow as a cooperative? This is dependent on the enabling environment. And many factors play a role and constitute the enabling environment, as you all know. Some are really underexposed, I would say. It's about institutions, but also historical factors, cultural factors, social factors, legal framework, the political framework, policy measures, and economic situation. Many factors. You can't say that one is dominant or not. One is really dominating the picture. It depends. Institutions, perhaps a little bit strange. Not so much attention has been devoted to this aspect. But you can imagine, you know, you've been traveling around, you know that every country is different. That the cultures and countries differ. The people have different motives, attitudes, norms, values, habits across the world. And this is very important, what kind of motives, arguments, attitudes, habits, norms people adhere to in countries. Because that determines a very large part of the dynamic environment. Are people inclined to work together or not? And perhaps you know Hofstede, but he has developed indicators telling you something about the cultural environment, cultures of countries around the world. Do people accept that the power is in the hands of just a few people, yes or no? So what a strange thing. But think about it. That is really instrumental whether cooperatives can thrive in a country or not. Or is a country characterized by individualism or collectivism? It's also one very partial aspect, very important for the enabling environment. So I can I will come back to this later, but these are very important factors when you look at the environment to take this into consideration as well. When you go in a country, where you operate in a country, what's the case? History is also very important. The enabling environment is not changed overnight. It's a result of many, many years, decades. And the enabling environment that we see now in every country or for every economic sector is also determined by the history. And things from the past can have a very lasting effect, good or bad, on the enabling environment. In quite some countries, a few decades ago, or in dictatorships, cooperatives were used for other purposes than being a cooperative. In some countries, civil servants were parachuted into the boards of cooperatives, and they were accountable to the government and not to the members. And this aspect is still playing a role in some countries. The cooperatives, I know I've spoken with many consultants and experts, still have a negative impact on the enabling environment. So take into consideration the history as well. Legal frameworks, cooperative law, very important as well. I'll come back to this later. But it also differs quite a lot. And most of the times, cooperative law and tax regimes, taxation of cooperatives, vis-a-vis other organizational forms, is also very important for the enabling environment. But they are mostly legal systems, legal frameworks, and tax regimes are mostly a reflection of all the other elements of the enabling environment. So they're all intertwined, they all interact, and when you want to say something about doing cooperative business and enabling environment, you have to take into account all these aspects. And a few of them are very important and can dominate the entire picture, or can dominate the enabling environment. History, culture, legal frameworks, whatever. Policy measures as well. Many policy measures have been taken, but there's no overview in the literature on the impact of policy measures on the performance of cooperatives. There's no unambiguous results in this respect. The same holds for all the elements of cooperative law. Is it beneficial or not for the cooperative development? It's very difficult to say so in general. You have to look, this is the main message, you have to look on a country-by-country basis to what's your enabling environment. And the environment can also differ across economic sectors. I know countries where there are many agricultural cooperatives, but no other cooperative is present or can be established. Is that a very good or bad enabling environment for cooperatives? I also know countries where there's such a thick cooperative law, everything is written down. And I know countries, the Netherlands, where we have this cooperative law. It's very flexible. Which one is better or worse? You can't tell. You can't say. So it's very difficult. You really have to dive into the country and see how it's really working. Okay, when everything is in order, perceived needs are there, enabling environment is okay, then the requirements for well-functioning internal governance are present. Internal governance of a cooperative. Meaning, well, but then it depends on whether there's a large cooperative economy, whether cooperatives are really functioning well. Is the governance functioning well? Is the membership policy active? How are the decisions taken? Is there capitalization possible? Is growth possible? Whatever. And there are also many papers on this topic at this conference. So if that's in order, internal governance as well, then you can see what the result is the cooperative performance or the size of the cooperative economy, resulting from all these elements. You say, well, that's interesting, and I must admit that there's a feedback loop from cooperative performance towards the enabling environment, of course. Cooperatives are, of course, influenced by the enabling environment, but if they reach a critical mass beyond a certain threshold, the cooperative sector has an impact on the enabling environment as well. But not when the cooperative sector is very small. Anyway, what I've looked at, cooperative performance in terms of member benefits and whatsoever, and market shares and viability, sustainability, societal goals, what you observe is actually the result of all the other factors. Then was the issue of defining the enabling environment. It's also very difficult. I told you this is the definition that we followed. And I have to point to the addition of being in line with the cooperative principles. You can have nations and societies and governments that support and foster cooperative firms in their establishment and subsequent development. But if it's not in accordance with all these principles, for instance, regarding autonomy, then it's problematic. So this is the definition that we used in this report for the enabling environment. Now the question is, that's nice to define this, that was already a big task, but now how can you operationalize this? You have enabling factors to really stimulate cooperative development, and as I told you, you have factors that are really impeding cooperative development and establishment of cooperatives. So the enabling indicator, ideally, this is a research conference, so let's do something strange. This is the definition of the enabling environment. Yeah. So, let's move on. Ideally, when you have all the information, the enabling environment can't be observed, right? So it's a construct of all the variables I just mentioned. Political dimensions, economy, cultural backgrounds, tax systems, history, whatever. So suppose that this is the enabling environment, and the X's are the variables. Suppose you have all these indicators and these variables. Can you construct this? Well, it's very difficult. What is the weight of each element for the enabling environment? You don't know. TC stands for the type of cooperative. The enabling environment, that was a question actually by the ICA, developed an indicator, a very nice overall one. So I worked on this for a week and I got headache, because this is mission impossible. Every cooperative sector is different. You have large cooperatives, transnational cooperatives, you have small cooperatives, health cooperatives, agriculture cooperatives, startups. You can't define one enabling indicator for a country or for a sector. Then there's a time dimension. Suppose you have everything, then how far are you going back in time? Because the enabling environment is as it not right now, but dates back a long time ago. So very nice intellectual exercise, but let's get away with this. This doesn't work, but these elements are very important. You have to take into account all these factors. Yep, go away, yes, that doesn't work. It's difficult. No databases on all this, actually. This is the road ends, not in Almeria, but this is a dead end road. So another direction is needed. So what I did, yes, look at this. Well, let's take a micro and macro approach. Let's really look what's in cooperative law, and can you compare cooperative laws across the country? There's a panelist, an editor, and there's another editor in the room who wrote this book, edited this book with many chapters. These 33 countries are in this book. I looked at it. I read the book. How many pages? 800 pages, yes. So I was very moved, I was very pleased, I was moved to tears because it looked so good on paper. Every country had a cooperative law, I said, well, this would be thriving. And then I spoke, I started to speak with the authors and other experts in the field. And then I got tears in my eyes again because it wasn't like this. It didn't work like this. There's a gap between what is de jure in the law and, as you all know, what is de facto happening. So it's nice to analyze this, and it's a very good starting point to take out the key characteristics of cooperative law in countries. But in some countries you have many cooperative laws for each economic sector. In the Netherlands you have one cooperative law pertaining to all sectors. And I think in Spain there's a cooperative law for every region, right? So, yeah, that was also nice. But anyway, I tried to get out the most salient details of cooperative law. That's very helpful if you want to establish a cooperative law, know what's going on, what the law says about this. And I consulted many experts apart from this, and also people from Rabobank actually helping set up cooperatives around the world. What do you see, what's important or not? And then something interesting happened again, because when I spoke to people writing these chapters, but also other legal experts, they had sometimes a completely different vision on the effectivity and efficiency and the usefulness of this law. So there's also disagreement about cooperative law among experts, lawyers, legal persons. Then I spoke to economists, they had a completely different picture on the impact of corporate law as well. Then I spoke to people with a social background. Anyway, you should, when you really write a corporate business report, doing a corporate business report, include a pool of experts with different backgrounds, otherwise you get a very biased picture of what's going on. So for the Netherlands, I did this. I'm not going through all this, but it's very nice to have the highlights, also with input from experts in this field. Just a few characteristics, very important ones, appearing on the slide. And this is, of course, a useful base to start discussions between authorities and the alliance. It's, of course, particularly about current issues, what is really the most important thing that has to be changed in order to boost the cooperative sector without being too supportive, otherwise you create unfair competition as well. It's also many sometimes the case. Policy measures, very nice, but they favor cooperatives and thereby destroying other companies. They're not rectifying market imperfections, but creating market imperfections. That happened as well. So current issues. And we are in Spain. I did the same for Spain. There were also presentations yesterday about the legal system in Spain. So it's very good to have such a micro database with the key aspects, with the views included, incorporated of many different experts from different backgrounds. Then you know what's going on and what an important aspect of the environment is. But it's not just about cooperative law, it's also about taxation law, competition law, labor law, whatever law, in combination with all the other institutions that I just mentioned. It's all true, Cynthia. I also spoke with you about this. I can't read it, but I included your very bright remarks as well, so it should be okay. So this is what I've done as well. It's also in the report. Then I thought, well, what is the size of the cooperative economy? What are the databases around? I looked at the readily available databases, which is very poor. Doing great effort at URIXA, I'm saying World Cooperative Monitor, but just looking at the very big ones, and there's more than that, of course, also regarding the impact of cooperatives. Most of the times, many times, the smaller ones have a huge impact, a bigger impact for the members than the very big one that happens. So, but it's very useful. But this database was by UNDESA, first global count of cooperatives around the world. Yet it's not perfect. It's not complete. I know all this. That's the best you can get. And it's composed of these factors. That doesn't say anything about other aspects of cooperative performance. Are members pleased or not? I know. But these are just, this is just the size of the cooperative economy. And can this size be linked to all the elements of the enabling environment I just told you about? If that's the case, if there are correlations, you should look at these indicators from now on to see whether the enabling environment, elements of the enabling environment, are improving or deteriorating for cooperatives. That's the idea. So these countries are included, the same as in your book. Collected all the data for these countries in this respect. And you can see here the size of the cooperative economy in these countries. If you don't agree, you think the data are rubbish, come to me and provide me the good data for your country. I'll be more than happy. Okay. According to this indicator, France is the most, is the country with the highest, the greatest, the largest cooperative economy. You can see that the picture is dominated by Western European countries, generally considered to be, of course, the birthplace for cooperatives, so not so strange. Dating way back, again, history in time. This isn't built up over 1 or 2 years. With the cooperative economy, the size is also a result of a very long period, like the enabling environment that doesn't change overnight as well. I collected these indicators with information about trust in society. Is the governance working? Is there corruption? Democracy? Well, cooperatives are economic democracy in action. So when a society is characterized by a high level of democracy, you can expect that this element of the environment is supportive or conducive for cooperative development. If there's a dictatorship, I think that might be somewhat else. So I tested this. Hofstede indicators, I'm not going through all this, is in the reports. 6 indicators defining the culture in a country. People are accepting the power in the hands of just a few people. What you see here is, and I also wrote down the countries where this pertains to, you can see that there's a negative correlation between power to distance and the size of the cooperative economy for these countries, according to all these indicators. So when the power is in the hands of just a few people, it's difficult for cooperatives to be established. If this indicator improves, you can say, I know, correlations are not about causality. I know. But I think that the causality runs two ways, could run two ways. If this improves, or the cooperative sector is expanding, that could have an impact on all these elements as well. Anyway, if you see movement in these indicators, that's my point, you can say something, those that are significant, you can say something about developments in the enabling environment at the macro level for cooperatives. The same for the governance indicators I looked at, collected for all these countries as well. Every governance indicator collected by the World Bank, I think it is, yeah, is significantly positively correlated with the size of the cooperative economy. Governance effectiveness, regulatory quality, rule of law, control of corruption. Of course, when this is wrong, it's very difficult for other businesses as well to be established and to thrive, yes, of course, but also for cooperatives. And the enabling environment for cooperatives is also one thing. Well, it could be very good, but perhaps the enabling environment for other firms is even better. So we also have to look at it in relative terms. Huh? That's also a complication. Very important to look at the development of these indicators per country, because then you have a notion, you have a clue what's happening with the enabling environment for cooperatives in the country. To show the results, these are all significant correlations. General doing business indicator, so how easy it is to establish a firm, to get electricity, a license, whatever, how long does it take? Again, positive correlation between the size of the cooperative economy for these countries and this indicator. So I've really detected some indicators that tell you something about the evolution of the enabling environment. Can be changed overnight, but monitor these indicators per country, ICA, and you have something to talk about with governments and other institutions to boost cooperative development, if wanted, if needed. Corruption, well, as I told you, very difficult to do business anyway when there's a high level of corruption, but certainly pertains to cooperatives as well. Countries characterized by, as characterized as clean, you see a larger cooperative sector than countries characterized by more corruption. You say, well, perhaps these calculations are influenced by outliers. I run these correlations without the outliers regarding the cooperative economy index and the other indicators, and that didn't really change the picture for this sample. Some more. Democracy, also highly positively correlated with the size of the cooperative economy, which is expected. In this report, also write what you can expect a priori regarding the link between all these indicators and the size of the cooperative economy. But did you expect a positive correlation between this democracy index and the size of the cooperative economy? And finally, income inequality is negatively correlated. If a few people in a country earn everything, it's very difficult to set up a cooperative, and it's a question whether they allow cooperatives to be established. So at the macro level, I have micro analysis, cooperative law with all these elements, these indicators. I need more data on the size of the cooperative economy that it's going to be working on, and then you have a nice picture. Just an example again, I know something about cooperative law in the Netherlands with the elements and the factors, the important factors. But if you collect the data and monitor this data from now on, good data, you can see what is happening actually with the enabling environment in a country. And these variables are available for all these 33 countries. Same for Spain. So really, to make it somewhat more objective, this assessment of the enabling environment, you should adhere to this. So what I suggested to the Alliance is, well, this Doing Cooperative Business report should contain four building blocks, ideally. All this data, the indicator for the enabling environment, a micro data set on the cooperative law, plus an assessment by all kinds of experts, what it really implies and is better or worse, or what elements should be changed in order to boost what's the silver bullet, so to speak, to boost cooperative development. But also set up a network, because you can activate your network alliance with all the experts and obtain input from them. Ask them 10 questions and you have a very good picture of what's going on and monitor this development from now on. However, last but not least, researchers, various specialists, of course the input from real practitioners at the real grassroots level operating a cooperative should be included well, because they are confronted with encouraging or discouraging factors all the time on a daily basis. And I think that this is doable, to include all these elements in doing cooperative business reports. So, to conclude, I'm not going to repeat this, it's also in the handout that you just obtained. It depends on many interactive factors, monitor these factors, and note that you have to look at it from on a country-by-country basis, case-by-case basis, with many different elements playing a role. And now we all want to download, of course, the report, and it can be found here. too quick. I know, but that was a joke. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. As you know, the structure of this conference and the abstracts and everything we made you identify whether you were dealing with micro, meso, or macro. And I think what we've gotten here is quite an emphasis on the macro, perhaps some of the micro. Now I'd like to have some commentary on this. So as I said, we invited our three responders. And perhaps we'll do it, shall we do it one by one? Or would you rather all sit up here? It's really up to you how you prefer to do that, okay? Use the steps, because I didn't and I fell. So be careful. All right, Pilar, shall we begin with you?
Okay, thank
you. Is that all right?
Okay. Hi, good morning, everybody. I'd like to thank you, Cynthia, for thinking of me for this table, for this little chat about the project of Hasselsberg. And I would like to start saying that your project is very, very interesting. The provisional conclusions seems very interesting to me and you know, original even, because I never thought about these institutional factors as, you know, so many relevance for the creation and the performance of the cooperatives. So I think, in my personal opinion, there are two factors of the ones you have pointed out that are perhaps the more relevant than would be the equality of the society, you know, the equality in the sense of economic equality, not very much difference between, you know, economic classes, and also gender equality, this one, and the quality of the democracy, the two of them. So democracy and equality would be the two factors, I think, from the ones you have selected, the ones I will remark. Anyway, it's not my job to analyze your job, because it's you have made this research. But I suppose I am here because I'm a tax lawyer professor, and I must say that I'm going to say something about tax law in the cooperative performance. I'm also, you know, the conductor of a research project about public policies in social economy institutions, and some other of my colleagues, not working on tax law but in another fields, have made me see there are two factors very important in the performance of the sector, you know, the cooperatives in a country. I would like to remark them. The two of them are legal factors. One of them would be, you know, the barriers for cooperatives to access some sectors as business. For instance, in Spain, we have some legal barriers for cooperatives doing electricity, producing electricity, and distributing electricity, for instance. And some legal, not barriers, but inconvenience for cooperatives doing transport by road, road transport by trucks and everything. This is difficult for cooperatives to do, more difficult than for capital societies. That's two examples of these legal barriers. The other thing I have seen from the work of my colleagues are the rules of public procurement. You know, the hiring services or buying products from the public administration, from companies, you know, the public procurement. And in this, because public procurement is a very strong instrument to incentive or disincentive some sectors, you know, some kind of societies, some kind of companies. If you are hiring all the time big companies for producing, delivering goods or services to the public administration or doing to the general population in the name of the public administration, you are, in fact, doing as much as giving them tax benefits. It's like giving a you know, some grants or something, because you are actually incentivizing it. So, if you have some public procurement rules, taking notice of the difference of the cooperatives, taking notice of the values of the cooperatives in the rules of the procurement, is more easy for cooperatives to live, to be created, and to perform well in a territory. You know, that is very important in the local development. You know, because you can see if the public procurement of, you know, the public administration is sensitive to cooperatives, the cooperatives will emerge. You know? We have seen that, for instance, in Catalonia, in Santander too, and now we are trying to do that in Valencia. So it's a working process too, to see, because we have seen the impact of that in the creation of cooperatives. And then finally, I can promise that I'm finished now. I talked very little about very briefly about taxation. You know? Yes, it's my job to notice that that is a very relevant factor in that, really. And the most important is not, you know, the tax law about tax treatment of cooperatives. That's a really important factor in the incentiving or not cooperatives. But in my opinion, it's more important to see that in most tax law, cooperatives are not even contemplated. You know, for instance, VAT. In the VAT, the law never speaks about cooperatives. Just once, something not important. So the VAT is adapted to capital companies, you know, so to capital sale companies. So it's very uncomfortable for cooperatives. So they are having problems all the time, you know, with the revenue income and with the tax office and everything. And the same on the corporation tax. On corporation tax, the legislator is all the time, you know, changing things and putting new incentives, putting new attractions for companies, and they always forget cooperatives. You don't know why, but they always forget cooperatives. So they don't access to the good things of the tax, you know, or the corporation tax. And it's a problem, because when you go to a lawyer or a counselor to start a company, you ask him, what is the best form to do that? And usually, most of the counselors answer you something like, well, you can do a cooperative, but it's very complicated, because corporation tax in cooperatives is very complicated to manage. And then you lose a lot of another tax incentives. So perhaps it's not the best idea to do a cooperative. And just the last thing to say is, this counselor usually doesn't know how to manage a cooperative. That would be, in my opinion, the last but not least factor to the performance of creating cooperatives. Most counselors in Spain doesn't know how to tax a cooperative, how to do the necessary paperwork, so they don't advise to do cooperatives. They don't advise you to make a cooperative when you are going with your idea of business. So education for this field is very important. And I think it's one of the most relevant factors in this issue. And I have nothing more to say. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yes, the barriers to entry is a very important point. And also for many people, I mean, it's not just, many people don't understand tax at all, whether it's co-op law, co-op tax or otherwise. And it's a very powerful instrument, as is these instruments of public procurement, et cetera. They're very interesting points.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Cynthia. First of all, I would like to thank this opportunity to make some comments and contributions on the very interesting presentation delivered by Professor Grunwald. The topic is a topic of relevance both to industrialized as well as to developing countries. I should point out, however, that my contribution is probably biased to the situation in developing countries, which experience as regards cooperatives often involves some unique aspects differentiating it from that of industrialized countries. A first and evident conclusion, which I share with Professor Grunwald, is the assertion that cooperatives are created by a group of people with a common need, which the cooperative is supposed to solve, and consequently, cooperatives are born out of need, and that is something that cannot be questioned. From there, we should consider the institutional factors, as well as others, encouraging or discouraging the existence of cooperatives. In sum, it would be pointless to reflect on favorable or unfavorable factors if the creation and development of cooperatives is an artificial product foreign to the needs of society. Now, it remains clear that the topic may be addressed from different angles, and consequently, it is possible that the conclusions reached would vary. If we take, for example, a historical approach, the answer will vary according to the circumstances of time and place, since different circumstances bring about factors which are in turn different and influence either positively or negatively on cooperatives. From a political and sociological point of view, the conclusion will vary according to the different public policies actually in effect in different countries, whereas from the legal standpoint, such conclusions will depend on what is provided for by the legislation in force in each country. In this last case, we should agree with the exceptions made by Professor Grunwald about the actual implementation of the corresponding legal provisions, since not always or not everywhere are they actually enforced. The documents issued by the international organizations illustrate in this topic. Although their general scope needs to be contrasted with the reality existing in each particular country, nevertheless, they provide a suitable guideline which is the result of experience and of variety of their members. The title of the Annex of Resolution of the United Nations 56-114, that is, guidelines aimed at creating a supportive environment for the development of cooperatives, defines its nature. The governments of the country members are not suggested to adopt measures for subsidizing cooperatives, but to create a supportive environment for them. Governments are not induced to set up and develop cooperatives, but to provide a supportive environment on which they may come into existence and develop by themselves. The same could be said about the ILO Resolution 193 concerning the promotion of cooperatives. There, it is stated that the governments should provide a supportive policy and legal framework consistent with the nature and function of cooperatives and guided by the cooperative values and principles. Both documents mention a series of policies and measures aiming at achieving those goals. But in any case, it should be kept in mind what is their fundamental purpose. It is not about artificially creating or supporting cooperatives, but about providing them with an adequate environment in which their present or prospective members may freely and willingly engage in their business, aimed at satisfying their various needs by means of their self-help and mutual aid. To the factors mentioned by the speaker, we should add the population's level of education. Since the more and better informed the citizens, the greater their possibilities of being aware of undertaking the creation and functioning of cooperatives. As an illustrative example of this, we could recall the experience of some countries and regions where the significant development of cooperatives was strongly linked with the education processes, mainly adult education, such as in Denmark or in New Scotland in Canada, Mondragon in Spain, etc. Further, respect for human rights is a particularly relevant factor, and among those rights, respect for freedom of association without controls or restrictions of a political nature or otherwise. Cooperatives embody the freedom of association, so their very existence is dependent on respecting it. Paradoxically, among the negative factors, we should include the policies for the promotion of cooperatives when they are of such nature as to jeopardize the independence. Particularly in developing countries, such policies may become distortive enough as to require the allegiance of cooperatives to the government and support organizations. And also, they weaken or eliminate the competitive capacity of cooperatives to develop on their own in the market. Finally, to the favorable factors, we should add the existence of an actual informants of cooperative-specific legislation, which takes into account the true nature of cooperatives, clearly different from that of capital and charitable organizations. The difference is evident in the fields, in every field of the activity of cooperatives, as well in tax-related aspects and in the field of competition law, consumer rights, and labor law in the case of the workers' cooperatives. Summing up, the best encouragement for cooperatives is to treat them according to their own nature. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Krakonia. I think it's a really a good reminder about the fact that it's a good reminder that freedom of association is so fundamental, mm-hmm. and we take that for granted in so many ways. So
pass the word on now to Professor Cook.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Cynthia, for asking me to react, give me a chance to read his abstract three times, and I look forward to reading the report. The first thing I'd like to do is to congratulate Professor Groeneveld for his courage in taking on this project. This is a mammoth undertaking, and I think it will spur many types of research and in many different countries, and having this, what I would call more rigorous macro framework will help the dialogue for many cooperative leaders in many countries as they deal with policymakers. I think for most of us who work with cooperatives or cooperative trade associations, I think this presentation gives us an excellent lens by which to view how a lender will look at those of us, those attempting to start or to maintain or to improve the performance of cooperatives. This financial view of how a lender, someone who would lend money to a group that perceives they have a need, is very important. And I don't think we can forget that this report was written by someone who's taking that point of view. They're extremely important. And still, until one has dealt with a lender who is attempting to protect their institution's viability, one doesn't appreciate the role of debtors or lenders. So that, I think, is a very important lesson for how this report was written. A third point, I would see in 5 years this report might become literally the textbook for teaching cooperatives around the world. I think it had the global viewpoint and the way you've organized it in the sense of, first of all, perceived needs. And I like how you start not with market failures as most who are economists would start with, but in the sense of poverty, exploitation, other probably feelings among the critical mass or the critical group that initiates collective action. I think those feelings are felt first before they think of it as a formal market failure. So I think this perceived need would be a very interesting way to start, at least at the universities and maybe in the secondary education, why one would study cooperatives. This is a really major challenge. Why study this type of business organization? And I think it's probably the only type of organization that would start with those type of words. Do you feel exploited? Do you feel excluded, etc.? So I really like that section. A second issue or approach that it appears, because we haven't seen the full report, is Professor Groeneveld emphasizes the importance of institutions. And I think the importance of institutions, at least in the social sciences, is underappreciated. And it appears that you draw that out. And it's when you're dealing with a group that feels excluded or is poor, etc., that It's difficult to communicate that. They need immediate attention, but it's institutions that perhaps have contributed to their situation. Then you move on to internal governance. I think internal governance is probably, if you look at the number of papers here, probably 50% of the papers, or maybe even more, is what we as researchers, it's kind of a micro view of how we view it. And then you end up with cooperative performance and you have a nice set again. Now, how does one measure these things? It's obvious that this is why I congratulated you on your courage, because you happen to be in a discipline that believes that measurement is important. These macro concepts are, and particularly comparative macro concepts, would be very challenging. I also appreciate your declaration that you have a balance, at least you claim you have a balanced view, that you like co-ops, but you also warn that cooperatives have to be very careful in not abusing the advantages that have been institutionalized in the legal system, the appropriate or specific legal institutions, or their market position. So I think that was important. Your conclusion, I think the conclusion gives those of us who work in studying the internal organization of co-ops, I think even though you take a macro view, I think you create some optimism for us by, I'm paraphrasing you here, a cooperative is not a cooperative is not a cooperative. The heterogeneity of how cooperatives are organized, not only between countries, but within countries, and within sectors within countries, how heterogeneous we are. And therefore, those of us who study have to be very comfortable, it seems, to deal with this variability, this set of differences. Now, I love the comments made by the two other reviewers, the importance of education. Since all we've seen was the presentation and a one-page abstract, I don't know if you address education and in education indices in the report, but I think that would be very important. One of the things that one notices when one looks very briefly at your results is how, I don't know how to read it from the point of view, the probability of success or the probability of existence or the probability of longevity, highly correlated with the degree of development of a country. And Mansur Olson, Professor Mansur Olson, always said, and this always shocked people in cooperatives, he said, what we have found is that cooperatives are an organizational model utilized more by the elite than the non-elite. And I think he said that because he was referring to how educated one must be, not necessarily in degrees, but how educated in civil, interrelationships one must be in order to govern and lead this type of organization, because it's much more complex than perhaps any other type of organizational model. And so that's, I don't know if that'll be in the conclusions or not, but that correlation kind of just struck out at me. So again, in concluding, I just want to congratulate you for, I'm assuming it's courage for undertaking this project. I think it will help all of us put into context our own areas of research. And so thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. We've seen, we have an economist, we have some lawyers, we have a person who's in finance, and I think it's really interesting, and we have many, many other disciplines in this room, and I think it's important that we consider our vantage point looking at cooperatives, but it's also interesting to see the vantage point we have or the opinion we have of each other's disciplines. So for example, when people talk about law, non-lawyers often look at it as a rather instrumental thing in a positivistic way, whereas lawyers themselves see it as something different, that it's not so much, it's not a rule to be implemented or not, but it could be a lot of other things, that it implies a certain kind of cultural or social capital as well. So the next stage of this session, and I have left quite a bit of time on it, because I want a lot of participation here as well. I think maybe Hans, if you have some comments that you'd like to direct to the commenters, and then I really want to open the floor for all of you to pose observations or questions to the four people that we have here, who are amazing, a wealth of knowledge. We're just so honored. Okay, I'll let you answer.
I have two microphones here. Is this working? Yeah, this is working. Better take it off.
Should be open.
This is working, yeah. Thank you very much for your comments. Very nice. I'm speechless. All these nice words, so what can I say? I won't consume too much of your discussion time, but one remark per panelist, I would say. Pilar, what you said about taxation and corporate tax and all these issues and whether it's in place or not, I think you really identified already one of the issues that, if changed, could boost the sector tremendously. So this is actually what I meant. Hearing from experts, what would really make the difference if you change something in the labor environment in this respect regarding taxation? So that's really exemplifying what I'm suggesting as a follow-up, actually. Thank you. So I've noticed this. Ms. Kakunya, thank you very much for your remarks as well. And yes, you emphasize the difference between developing countries and other countries, or Western countries to industrialized countries. Yes, they're confronted, obviously, with totally different challenges, issues, corporates active in these countries. Different scale, different constellation, so we have to take this into account as well. Heterogeneity. Mr. Cook as well, yeah. Thank you very much for your nice words. Also emphasizing education is very important, yes. So the definition is, well, can cooperatives grow the enabling environment with addition according to the seven principles, cooperative principles. And as you know, one of the principles is education. Not only internally for members, how it functions, because you really have to get a lot of knowledge because it's complex, to explain what it is to be a member of a cooperative, what the rights and obligations are. That's a big challenge, I can tell you, from experience of Rabobank in these countries. But also education to the wider public. What is a cooperative? What does it mean? What are the specifics? What can it address or not? What can it do or not? And what is the story around it? So that's very important, and I touch upon this as well as one of the major issues. I would like to leave it here, but thanks very much for all your nice words.
Now it's your turn. Okay, we have hands already. Okay, so let's start with, on this side of the room, may I have a person for the microphone, please?
Good morning, my name is Hagen Henry from the University of Helsinki. Thank you to Hans, first of all, with whom I had the pleasure to discuss several times on the end. I will certainly read the final product or the almost final product, and then we have a chance maybe to talk again. Thank you also to the commentators. I would like to limit my comment to what Dante said, not surprisingly, because lawyers like to talk amongst themselves. The first point is that you said, well, we should distinguish between developing and industrialized countries. I'm not so sure anymore whether this divide is, is there. I think we have in an increasing number of industrialized countries pockets of underdevelopment. And plus we have a thing which we call globalization. So I think that will do effectively away, or has done away already, with this divide, and we have to come up with other ways of thinking. And I come back to that when I talk about law. Coopers being a child of need, yes. But the question is, of course, is how do we define the need? And what I want to say is that we have, and we didn't really realize, there is a change with the emergence of the welfare state. Coopers became a child of choice. There were and there are alternatives. And I think what the need really is for those who have a choice to do it otherwise is that they're not satisfied the way other types of enterprises would address their needs. So they choose to do it in a different way without having a basic need to go through cooperatives. And that I say that because that I think made a split in the cooperative law. That is where the cooperative law started to go into different directions. The other issue, which is said, well, let's not only look at the laws as such, I mean, the written law, the text, it's much more about the implementation. I think what makes law is to see these things together. It's not law and then we think about implementation. When starting to make a law, we should think about the implementation. Is it possible, that this nice text I'm elaborating will be implemented? If not, I should stop elaborating it. Because a law which is not implemented, in fact, is not a law. And then I come back to this issue of globalization. I think in the era we are living in, we have to rethink the whole mode of making, who is actually making the laws. We are out of the situation where national legislators would sit in a parliament and do a national law for the Netherlands or Germany. That, I think, we are really living in a multi-layered global legal system where many other lawmakers, so to speak, are actually making the laws, not the parliamentarians. And I come to my last point. I have to see what it is, really. It's about the ILO recommendation 193, and I think you were expecting that. What I see, and you know quite well, of course, I think there is a line here. I mean, we start with the ICA statement, we come to the UN United Nations guidelines, and then we end up chronologically with the ILO recommendation concerning the promotion of cooperatives. And I, as you know, I would like to remind especially legislators, and now I'm talking about states, governments, that there is a legal obligation to promote cooperatives in the way you described. It's not a matter of a recommendation. We have the legal obligation. And there are many arguments to say so, but I think it's not enough for governments to lean back and say, well, every second year we decide on a text, and then we say, well, it's only a recommendation, we can choose now what we want to do. No, they have an obligation. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So I think what we'll do is we'll collect our comments by three, mm-hmm. maybe, and then we can respond to things. Okay?
Okay.
So the next comment, there's two over here, Giovanni, and I'm sorry, I don't know your name, and then we'll move over this way. Okay.
Yes, hello, this is Giovanni Ferri from Lumsey University of Rome, Italy. First of all, I wish to congratulate Hans. We know each other since long time, so I don't call him Professor Grunfeld. It's a very nice project, and you laid down in a very effective way. I liked your presentation. Of course, you are expecting from us suggestions or things that can still be improved. So I will touch upon two. The first one is about how to frame this inside the global agenda. And it's possible that I am not totally informed of what is inside the project. But just based on your presentation, I would try to link it better, this issue that you're trying to put forward, I would try to link it better with the sustainable development goals of the United Nations. And in particular, there are several linkages between the cooperative movement in its many varieties and how these having this richness of corporate structures and motivations in society can lead to a more sustainable economic environment and social environment, and also towards more sustainable environmental practices. Much of this conference itself is about that. So I think that it's rather the rule than the exception that you find in the cooperative movement very strong links with some general principles like the 2030 Sustainable Development Goals signed in September 2015 at the United Nations. The other point is more technical, and it has to do with the presentation of the presence of cooperative sector that you outlined in that nice graph about 33 countries. Now, it is very good what you did, and I guess many other researchers have done that, included myself, that given that there is no official statistics on the presence of cooperatives in different countries, we tend to rely on the Global 300, if I can recognize your source. The Global 300 exercise was indeed initiated by thanks to the idea of a previous International Cooperative Alliance initiative in the past. So we should be proud of that. Now there are out at least three waves of that exercise. But as much as we should be proud that we have been able to provide some international comparison, some good data on large cooperative enterprises. And in these, we are, if you wish, going back to the origin of the cooperative movement, the international cooperative movement 100 years ago. They were very attentive at elaborating international statistics. We are not so much today. But given that, at the same time, we should not give the false impression that there is enough statistics, because this is a very unsatisfactory situation, and you are fully aware that you are giving a representation of the countries depending on whether there are large cooperatives or small cooperatives. There will be a bias. I mean, if you have sub-developing countries that have small cooperatives, there might be millions of those, but they will not be in the Global 300. So you may have very strong biases in that comparison. So my point is, good to use this data because it is the only available, but at the same time pointing out that there is a need for national statistical bureaus and for the international treaties to recognize the fundamental need that providing equal treatment for firms and for different corporate organizations means also collecting statistics on what they do and what they are. Thank you.
Okay, we'll collect our one-third comment back here. We'll have a response from our panel, and then we will move to some other hands that we had seen before. Okay? And I'm going to have my gender bias here. I'm not going to allow only men to speak. I want some female participation here.
Thanks. My name is Morris Altman, University of Newcastle, Australia. Thanks for this is a great initiative. I just want to make a few very short points. One, I haven't gone through all the analysis, but I think it would be important in your report as it's finalized to give clarity in terms of the biases, if any, of the estimates that you use. The other thing, my eyes aren't that good, but there's a lot of scatter in the data points, and I think that needs to, analytical narrative, because the more scatter you have, of course, it casts some it can generate some interesting narratives across different countries, because what works for one country may very well not work for another. Another point is your use of statistical significance. I think that could be highly misleading, because statistical significance tells us absolutely nothing about whether or not your coefficients or your estimates are actually of economic or social or substantive significance. Right? It just tells you whether or not, if you repeat your analysis, it's a fluke. Right? If there's what's the probability of it being chancy? So I think in terms of a robust analysis, what's really important to emphasize, perhaps, is to what extent is your results or the size of your results of substantive or of analytical significance? Thank you.
Okay, so we'll pause for a response from the panel on this. Professor Coconut.
I just will take 2 points raised by Hagen in his very thoughtful remarks. Of course, I agree with the question of globalization, which is reducing the distance between cooperatives in the developed world and in the developing countries. But as far as needs is concerned, I think that the withdrawal of state from many fields of activities is creating new needs. So today is not just a matter of choice, it's a matter of new needs that arising from new situations. So cooperatives have to respond to those needs. Secondly, as far as law and enforcement, I know and I think that the speaker pointed out it clearly that a question is, there are two different questions. One is the law itself, law in book, and another question is law in practice. We know countries where they have very good laws, if we judge them from the academic point of view. But if we look at the practice, the question is notably different. So, not always both things are linked. Sometimes, and more often than we could think, they go different ways. Good laws, bad practice. And another point that was raised by and some other from the floor is about statistics. I think that during the last few years, great efforts are being done to improve the situation, because it's true that statistics are still rather poor. And I have read the draft of the document written by Professor Grunewald, and I have listened to him in his intervention in Antalya last year, and he stressed, and I agree with him, that we need statistics very, very much better than today in order to be able to speak about cooperatives with more, with greater foundations. So a statistic is still something to be improved, even when in the few years, in the few last years, the situation has been ameliorated. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Well, you hear me? Yes. Thank you very much for your questions. There are two specifically directed towards me. Giovanni, thank you for your intervention as well. It's a good suggestion to link it up, all these insights, with the sustainability discussion going on right now. I think genuine cooperatives can really contribute to this debate, genuine, yeah, in all the aspects. So that's the world behind this word already. But I think that they really can contribute to this discussion, and they should deserve a place in the discussion, which is not happening at the moment, right now, yet. Luckily, I can easily take away a misunderstanding, because this data that I used are not based on the World Cooperative Monitor, the 300 largest cooperatives, no. This database I used is from UNDESA, and it is a count of as many cooperatives in as many countries around the world, including the large ones, but also the very small ones. So millions, and I think, I don't know, 40 million cooperatives are counted in this database, and I used this for the base of my calculations. So it's not just about the large ones, because that would really mean a bias in many respects, of course. The large ones are completely different, of course, than the smaller ones in economic terms. Then there was a question about the robustness of the analysis. Yeah, I wish I would have more data. But I can tell you that the conclusion, the correlations are significant, and also the values. I also tried to check the robustness, as I told you, by removing outliers. That's also one thing. And of course, you need perhaps more information, more data, more countries, and whatsoever. But that's pretty much okay. I used to be a quantitative macroeconomist, so that should be okay. Thank you very much.
Any more responses? No? Okay, let's take some more questions. Marcus, you're gonna have to change your gender. I'm teasing you. Linda and then Marcus, then you can talk. Okay, Linda first.
Hi, Linda Shaw. Thank you again for the paper. I think it was very illuminating. I wanted to follow on from the question about how we link to the broader agenda and sustainable development. And again, you may cover it in depth in your paper, but I was a little surprised that you weren't addressing the rights-based agendas here, human rights, human development index, gender-based rights, as one of those measurements, because it seems to me that that's a very large area within international development about rights-based development. I don't see cooperatives in it at the moment, and I think it would be a valuable area for us to engage with, but also for you to use the rights-based indices, HDI, some of the gender empowerment indices, alongside some of the more economic ones. So can we look at perhaps bringing those two perspectives more closely together?
So then Marcus, and then we had a very patient hand over here by Charles. Okay, and then I think we'll have that three, the response, and I want a last commentator, if I can, another woman to hear a female voice, and if not, where do we have it? Over here, there we go. And then finally, to round out the three, we can have Gil, no? Okay, so that's what we are. So where are we? No, Marcus was the next one, sorry. Sorry.
Thank you very much, Cynthia, for accepting me, even though it will take a little while until I change my gender. So Hans, congratulations for this very nice report. I had the pleasure to read it, and I'm very impressed about also the humble approach in digging in this data, so that you never make a statement that overstates the data set, I think. But looking a little bit ahead, to, let's say, the next Doing Cooperative Business report, I'd be really interested to get your advice on how a wish list of improving the data set would have to look like. So what can we promote in terms of improving the database? What do you want to see coming from international databases that are around, and what were the major gaps that you think needed improving in the next years? Can you comment on that a bit? That would help us.
Now you're looking at me, where there's and I might go next, and now I've even forgotten my own order. So we have a comment, we had a comment from Linda, we had a comment from Marcus, and I think I agreed that then it was Charles, is that correct? No. Where did I go? Okay, we go over there, okay.
I was curious as to how you accounted for cultural and ethnic factors in your analysis, and also religious factors, those that have certain attitudes and predilections regarding financing in particular, in respect to what appears to be a bias to Judeo-Christian value systems and a practice that tilts toward a preference to what we understand to be democratic action, because surely cooperation can exist in other cultural contexts.
Sorry, can you just tell us your name?
Sorry, Carol Corin.
Thank you. Do we have a response?
Thank you very much for these comments and suggestions to expand the analysis and to take into consideration other very important elements as well, like human rights, yes, gender issues, yes, that's true. What I really try to do, actually, that's, according to my opinion, relatively new, to emphasize the importance of these institutions and societal, sociological factors in looking at, is it possible to do cooperative business? And in societies where human rights are respected or not, that's also one of the elements, of course, constituting as a partial element of the total environment. I just wanted to stress by this and emphasize that we shouldn't only look at economic indicators or governance indicators whatsoever or cooperative law, but precisely take into consideration all these cultural factors that you're all kind of referring to. Because that's really underexposed, and when you forget about this, you're not getting to the core, and you can't really start a discussion with governments or other institutions in the country where you don't know what's going on in this area, what's happening there. Then you really miss one in terms of this equation, the enabling environment. If this is a very overriding one, human rights, if all these other factors in place, why is it not happening? And is this factor that you miss one very important variable? That is actually my, from a somewhat higher perception, education level, how I look at it. And so, points well taken, and should really be included in this as well. The same holds for your remark. It's also more or less in the same line regarding the cultural aspects and lending. And look at other factors than the usual suspects, I would say. That's also one of my main messages in this report. There was also a question looking ahead, advice, what can we do to promote this report or to improve the database? Well, it's so all-encompassing, it's so broad. I suggest, well, this is the foundation. These are indicators that are really important, that I should monitor this, should monitor the number of cooperatives, in which sectors are they appearing or not, or is established or not. In the Western world, it's not anymore an agricultural sector or financial sector. No, It's health, energy, education, but that is really remaining under the radar yet. Whereas in other countries, in developing or emerging markets, it's still very important that the agriculture sector is increasing its productivity and poverty of smallholders, and you know the story, is reduced. So I think step by step, I think it would be handy to, or also doable, to start with a better database on agricultural cooperatives worldwide, due to the facts I just mentioned, coupled with the sustainability arguments. And in combination or together with the FAO, and also the World Bank was looking at this. So I would suggest step by step, first get a clear picture of all agricultural cooperatives and what's going on in this area by working together with all these other institutions.
Okay, we have, I promised, one over here, and we have a question here. So to make, you don't have to run across the floor. Why don't we start with this question here, and then we'll finish up with two over here, and unfortunately then our time is over, so we'll have Charles and then Gilles.
Okay, I have just two quick questions. The first one, I would be very curious to know which factors are not correlated with the cooperative economic index. And second, I would like to ask you what most surprised you in this study. What was the result that really challenged you as a researcher?
That was a good question. I like that.
Oh, that's true. I'm so excited about the question. I was ready to go. Okay, Charles, and then Hugh.
I'm Charlie Rock. I'm from Florida, which is means that I'm here, and it feels really cool to be here, temperature-wise, that is. My bias, I'm an economist, and I'm an advocate of radical democratization and sort of citizen participation in every institution possible to make a better society. I guess, let me just sit down so I can ask the question a little bit more clearly. I guess I don't necessarily expect an answer on this, and I would pose this to the whole panel as well as to the audience. And I guess I'm asking because you provoked me to think. You did such an incredibly deep and wonderful project. You must have looked at many, many, many things. And I'm wondering, okay, put it closer, sorry. The question is about any data or any sources that people might look for data that deal with micro aspect, that is, within cooperatives, levels of participation or democratization, not only the members, but also other stakeholders, in particular, what I'd call intimate stakeholders, like the employees in non-worker co-ops, who share a keen economic interest in the success of the co-op, but are not members or voters of the board often. And I was wondering if you had any ideas about this, both in law and even more difficult, probably in practice. Thanks.
Okay, final question here to Hugh, if you can identify yourself for the young woman.
Here. Hello, I'm Hilton. I have a question for Professor Groeneveld. It's an observation and perhaps also a suggestion for a follow-up data collection. In your title and in your sources, you refer to the Doing Business Index of the World Bank. In the Doing Business Index is based also on surveys to experts in many countries, and they ask about a whole list of things related with business development. I think that it would be interesting to know the difference between the answer on those questions about businesses in general and the answer of those questions for cooperatives specifically. For instance, one of the questions that they ask is how much time does it cost to form? And that's one of the interesting issues with cooperatives, that is often a problem. It takes more time than a firm. The other thing is the costs of establishing a cooperative or a firm, which is also a decisive factor. And another question which they ask is, for instance, what's the annual payment that you have to do? And in several countries, there is an issue of institutional corruption or heavy taxation on within the cooperative sector, which is also interesting to identify. The advantage of those questions is that they are actionable. Many of the indicators which you present are interesting to explain and to explore, etc., but they are not very actionable. Democracy, Gini coefficient is not something that as a cooperative sector you can work on, while those other nitty-gritty meso things are things where you can also have political activities as a cooperative sector.
Thank you. Okay, responses?
Yeah, thank you very much again for valuable questions and comments and suggestions for follow-up. The first question was which factors that looked at are not correlated with the cooperative economy, right? The index. Well, I didn't touch upon every indicator. I selected 26 indicators, different ones, for all these 33 countries, so impossible to answer this one by one. But it's in the report. One that wasn't correlated, and it has to do with partly with human rights and gender issues, is Hofstede also looks at masculinity versus femininity. So how is a society organized? Is it solidarity, yes or no? There's a description in the report as well what how this is defined. So this is also included, but that was not, again, for this sample of countries was not correlated. It could change, of course, when you look at subsamples of countries, which will be even more interesting. Countries with a similar background, similar history, or whatsoever. I am fully aware of this, so it can be refined. But again, it's nice to acknowledge, very important to acknowledge, that these factors really play a very important role and could have an overriding impact on the enabling environment, which was, as emphasized also by the commentators, which hasn't been emphasized that much so far. And when you don't do this, you miss a lot. You're talking actually about things that don't really matter because there are other things that are more important. I was most surprising result as a researcher. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not a specialist in cooperative law. And now I think I'm a walking encyclopedia in this respect regarding cooperative law. So I learned a lot about this. And of course, you know this when you think about it, but it's really good law versus bad practice or vice versa. And that the interpretations of the law are so different, and that's not the overriding factor, because it's when you read about this and you look at the site of the ICA, it's very important. It's high focus, strong focus on legal frameworks. This is just one part of the puzzle, and that was really, I knew this already, but it was so obvious from all the things that I've learned, and also via all kinds of inputs from other experts in many different areas, that interpretation is very different, the views on corporate law is very different, and there are many more factors that really play a role. So that was really hitting me, apart from these factors, institutions, which were under the radar for a long time as well, also regarding myself. Another question was from Florida regarding the governance. Yeah, that's a very difficult one too. And this is one of the factors determining the success or failure of a cooperative, member involvement in workers. That's also, of course, a distinction has to be made. We have different kinds of cooperatives. You have a distinction according to economic sectors, but also consumer, producer, and worker cooperatives with completely different issues and aspects and whatsoever. So we can discuss this over coffee, I would say. Then a suggestion by Giel from also from the Netherlands for follow-up. Yeah, it would be very nice to have specific questions directed also in these surveys, global surveys on cooperatives. How easy is it to set up a cooperative? How many days? What's the cost? Well, that hasn't been done. There's no real opportunity to discriminate or to filter out these questions pertaining or answered by cooperators. It's very difficult, but it would be very interesting, of course. I fully agree with you. The same holds for taxation. I didn't address that issue that much, but you did. Also very important and differs a lot, of course. So there, yeah, we need more data, but I'd like to emphasize again, please take into consideration the entire enabling environment, including institutions, including legal frameworks, the policy, the history, and whatsoever. Then you can really understand, and it was also one of the findings, that certainly, at that point, you are only able to understand where a property sector stands in a country and where it comes from.
Do we have any more comments from the panel? No? Okay. Well, then we shall close this session. We're a little bit behind. Okay, so I didn't take my own advice. Please finish coffee at 15:15 and go to your sessions. Chairs, please enforce the time periods. And as I said, I'd like those reports or just lists of suggestions so we can put something together by tomorrow morning. Buses leave at 6 for the cooperative visit. They leave at 8 if you don't want to go on the cooperative visit. I imagine it'll be a reasonably late night. We won't keep you out till 3 in the morning, but you'll probably get back at around midnight. And we have the dinner, and then we have the flamenco, okay? Any questions, please grab one of the organizers, and we can answer them. Okay, thank you very much. And thank you. Let's give a great hand to the panel.